I'm Jake Tapper, live in Washington, alongside Wolf Blitzer, Chris Cuomo, Dana Bash on Capitol Hill. Welcome to our viewers in the United States and around the world for CNN's special coverage of the impeachment trial of President Donald J. Trump.
In just 1 hour, the Senate gavels back into session, and we'll be watching to see if the president's defense team will address the damning new information from former National Security Advisor John Bolton's book. The New York Times reports a draft manuscript details a conversation in August whereby the president explicitly told Bolton that he wanted to continue withholding U.S. military aid to Ukraine until Ukraine helped with investigations, including an investigation aimed at former Vice President Joe Biden. Republican Senator Mitt Romney now saying he wants to hear Bolton testify.
I can't begin to tell you how John Bolton's testimony would ultimately play on a final decision, but it's relevant, and therefore I'd like to hear it. What impact that might have would be dependent upon all the facts associated with it. We'd hear from, obviously, prosecution and defense as to what was relevant and what was said and how that might influence our final vote. But I can't begin to tell you how that would be resolved. I've indicated, I see myself as a senator juror. And in that capacity, I will maintain impartiality to the extent I can.
Senator, have you spoken to any of your Republican colleagues? Do you get the sense that more of them will be on board with voting for witnesses? Four of you need to say yes. Do you think there are four votes?
I think it's increasingly likely that other Republicans will join those of us who think we should hear from John Bolton.
It's interesting that he's suggesting that there might be four, get to 51. Then you can bring in witnesses, but at the same time, the Republicans will demand they want witnesses as well, including the Bidens.
Remember that the defense case, what the defenders of President Trump said on the floor of the Senate, was that all of this idea that the aid was tied to these investigations that President Trump wanted, that all of this is speculation from Gordon Sondland, and there are no firsthand witnesses. Now, that's not true. We have Mick Mulvaney on the record saying that there indeed was a link between the delay of the aid and a desire for the investigation into Ukraine in 2016. But putting that lie aside, John Bolton and what he is claiming, obviously, would be completely relevant. But while on the subject of that one lie, as long as we're addressing it, let me bring up this tweet from President Trump earlier today. The Democrat-controlled House never even asked John Bolton to testify. And then he goes on to say it's up to them, not up to the Senate. The idea that the House of Representatives never even asked John Bolton to testify is just a lie. It's false. There's a letter I'm holding in my hand right now from October 30th in which the three chairmen, chairs of the relevant committees in the House of Representatives asked John Bolton to testify. So they did, in fact, ask him to testify. Now, whether they subpoenaed him, that's another matter, because there was this whole subpoena argument that was going on. But the idea that there was no request for Bolton to testify, completely false. Yeah. Completely false. Let's go to Chris Cuomo now.
And remember, Jake and Wolf, the key is the president knows it's false. He knows what happened and why the House laid off the subpoena with Bolton, because the attorney for Bolton was very clear about what path it would take and what that would mean, and that it was a time battle. They didn't want it. So the state of play on Bolton as a witness, though, does have a twist in it. Senator Lindsey Graham, one of the president's biggest defenders, saying he would like to see the Bolton manuscript. All right, now we talked about this earlier. We have John Dean, Jeffrey Toobin, Laura Coates, and Ross Garber. So, Ross, maybe Senator Lindsey Graham was listening to you and said, I hate him less. Let me see what he says.
I don't want to take the blame for that.
We don't get Bolton's testimony. That's complicated. Privilege and what happens and who else and horse trading. But the manuscript, what could he be done according to Lindsey Graham?
Yeah, as we said a little while ago, either a subpoena for the manuscript and they change hands and there's no time to get to court, or the administration voluntarily provides the manuscript to the Senate. I take Senator Graham's comment to mean, all right, we'll take the manuscript, then we will decide, first of all, whether it needs to be part of the record, which it probably will be. But then second, do we even need him as a witness? We have his We have his words. We have dozens of pages of his account of things. Maybe we don't need him as a witness. I think that's the thing to watch for now. Mm.
Jeffrey, how does that play?
Well, I mean, the story gets more and more complicated. I mean, you know, Simon & Schuster, his publisher, and John Bolton himself have under their control the ability to solve this problem. Just come here and give an interview. Release the book. I mean, I think there is a patriotism factor at play here where, you know, I think we all recognize that the impeachment of a president is an extremely serious thing. We also recognize that John Bolton has highly relevant testimony and a book he's written. Why is an editorial assistant at Simon & Schuster allowed to read this, but the 100 senators are not? I mean, there is something wrong with that
copyright
idea.
Copyright issue?
Well, I mean, let's put aside the legal issue for a second, but just sort of the ethical issue. It's like, is it really more important to release the book on March 17th as opposed to January 30th?
Well, but Bolton's been doing this all along, right? He had his lawyer play games about whether or not he would accept it. He's been selective with his patriotism. But what happens, John Dean, if this changes and Bolton's like, you know what, I didn't think it would play out this way. I guess I do have to offer up the manuscript. To Laura's point, now it all becomes free, which is a great twist of the knife by Trump at Bolton. But what happens? Would the manuscript be enough?
Well, first of all, it's hearsay, clearly. That hasn't been a big prohibition in evidence in this case so far, but that certainly is as regards his testimony. So all it is a suggestion of his testimony and hearsay of what he might say.
Even if the manuscript reads, "This is what he told me," the manuscript in and of itself cannot be as competent as his actual testimony.
That's exactly right. It's certainly not the best evidence. So that's the first problem. Secondly, Bolton, as Jeffrey has been saying, as a patriotic matter, could hold a press conference tomorrow, today, come to your show this evening, you know, whatever, and put the word out. Here's what I know. Here's the relevance of it. Here's why I signaled I had vital information. And he should do that. Why he would want to withhold that now that it is so clear he has this information is a mystery.
You know, I think about strategy all the time, and I anticipate if I were the defense team, what would I do? And I think the Democrats have to be very careful about putting all their eggs into the Bolton basket, because it still holds true that the defense is going to say, well, this is now going to be a he said, he said. Okay, fine. He comes out there and he says that this is what this man told me. The president wanted to condition aid. It's not really substantively different. We heard from, say, a Bill Taylor or a Fiona Hill or Gordon Sondland, frankly, at this point. And so they would say to themselves, okay, well, now it's a he said, he said. And his defense is still the same. That's not true. That's not true. And you have bad blood when you left the actual White House. And so you're trying to stick it to us. And in reality, I was conditioning aid only about corruption generally, not about a political opponent. And I was doing so for the interest of the national security of our entire nation. And so in many ways, as far along as we get from the revelation, which is a revelation about having firsthand accounts of Donald Trump, you're in the same boat for a lot of the senators to say, well, does this move the needle for me personally? Have I learned that much more that's going to be able to undermine what I know will be the defense? And I don't think it is yet.
What makes the situation so extraordinary, I mean, the is that we are debating about facts that are known in the world.
Right.
It's not like a mystery. Like, there are emails. Every government decision in the past 50 years has documents us underlying it. American policy with regard to Ukraine is no exception. There are emails in the White House, in the National Security Council, on this subject. How can the Senate, in good conscience, make a decision of this magnitude, knowing that this evidence is out there and not getting it, that these witnesses...
The same way the House did, right? I mean, you know, the House rushed this along. They got the information. They controlled the timing of this. That piece I understand. You know, the Senate saying, you guys, you put together this case, you brought it to us. The rules favor the House. The rules automatically let the House spend 3 days putting in every piece of information they wanted, whether they collected it or they saw it on TV, it didn't matter. I could see the Senate saying, no, that's not how it works. We're not now going to have, you know, a year and a half trial and go to court and all of those things.
But if you view And it's an imperfect analogy, but a useful one. As the House as the grand jury and the Senate as the trial jury, the grand jury never gets every single piece of evidence.
It's not just imperfect. It's inapposite. That's not how it. That's not the structure. Impeachment is not a grand jury. It's a completely different process. You know, these House members had to be in a position where they voted. It was the only vote that the House gets to take on whether the president should be removed from office. That's what the impeachment says, is that the House of Representatives believes that the president should be removed from office, and then it goes to the Senate for a trial.
Ross also says that the Senate must try the case, and I think it is apropos to talk about a grand jury as an analogy for this reason alone. The idea of an indictment is never the ceiling for what you have to meet for your burden of proof in a criminal prosecution. The articles of impeachment are also not the ceiling. They shouldn't be the floor and the bare minimum to just meet just enough to impeach a president. But the idea that you wouldn't have to then have witnesses or try a case just because it's not a grand jury, I think, lets the Senate off the hook.